We've heard a lot so far about communications and how to communicate best with people. And I'm going to give you one technique that we use to do that in a political campaign. And before we start, it's important to understand this is a 4 to 6 hour lecture that we're giving in 1 hour, because I've heard you're so advanced that you'll get this so quickly. It will only take you 1 hour. But we're going to go through it pretty quickly. And it's a technique that's used particularly in political campaigns, but it also applies throughout the non-campaign season. It's a message grid. It was developed about 40 years ago, and both sides use this in the States. It's used in other countries now because training has been conducted. The left uses it more now than the right does, even though conservatives developed it. But they're used to stealing things from us. So it's important to understand, because the left will be doing this to you when they communicate, and you need to understand the techniques that they are using so you can counter them and, of course, do it better to them than they do to you. Before we start, there's a few basic premises that we have to discuss. Rick mentioned earlier that if you're in this room today, you are not, I don't want to say you're not normal, because then people say that I'm insulting them because I'm saying they are abnormal people, and that's not nice. So I will say you're not average. You are above average, because very few people in Croatia are talking about campaigns and politics today. And that's important to understand, because you're trying to communicate with average people who are very busy in their lives. And that's why it's very important that you understand they probably don't care as much about these issues as you do. So you have to give them a way to look at the issues and agree with you in very short time. So that's what we're going to develop. You'll see as we develop the technique. And then we'll talk about issues after we've developed the technique for messaging. You also heard Rick talk about vision. You heard Ron talk about values and vision. So that's what we're going to be talking about. So don't worry. We'll get to issues. I don't want people to think that I'm saying issues are not important. They are very important, but they're just not important yet. They'll be important in around 20 minutes. Then they'll be important. We'll bring it back, okay? So people are familiar, I hope, with Barack Obama. Yes? You've heard of him? Okay. And I like to use a specific campaign so we can explain this technique. So I'm going to use Barack Obama's second campaign for president, when he ran for re-election, against Mitt Romney. Okay? And we're going to develop, it's a message grid. It's called the Leesburg grid because it was developed in Leesburg, Virginia. But it's a message grid. Are there people here who are in the business world? Anyone who is in business here in Croatia? A few people? So you're in marketing and you know how to market products and you know how to market different... that's what this is. We're marketing candidates instead of products, but it's very much the same thing. Okay? But instead of trying to convince people to buy your product, you're not looking for 1% of market share. You're looking for 51% of the voters to agree with you so that you can govern. So it's a little different, but it's very similar. So this is branding. You're branding your, not your product, it's not toothpaste, it's not soap, but you're branding your political party, you're branding your leaders, and you're branding your issues. Does that make sense? And this is a technique to explain how to do that. Okay, so it turns into a grid. Can everyone see the blue ink? Okay, good enough. That's it. Is everyone still with me now? Okay, so you are advanced, because sometimes some people get lost here. So the upper left grid will be the Mitt Romney R versus R, R on R. It's Mitt Romney's message grid for Mitt Romney's campaign. So it's going to be positive, okay? The upper right will be Romney's grid on Obama. So it's going to be a negative grid. Now, the other side gets to play along also. You can't just do this. You have to pretend you're the other side. So down here, this will be Obama's messaging about Romney and Obama's messaging about Obama. And that's the four message grids. Now, your system is much more complicated because you have multiple political parties. We'll get to that in about 30 minutes. That's why they gave me an hour. But we want to develop it first in the simplest way, which is two people, two parties, okay? Much more simple, but we'll get there. So let's start with this box first. Imagine you are Mitt Romney's campaign team, okay? And the question you have to answer is, when a voter sees the name or hears the name Barack Obama, what negative branding or negative things do you want to think about Barack Obama? So I would say this is his re-election, right? He was divisive. His presidency was a failure, so he was a failure. His policies were a failure. His presidencies were a failure. He represents the old. And people had thought at this point that he was kind of lying to them. He had lied about many things, but they had lost trust in him. Trust is a very important quality to have. And if the other side does not have it, it's a good thing to talk about. So people distrusted him. And so distrust. Now, when you do this in real life, you may have 100 things in this box, all the negative things about the other person. I like starting here because you're putting your lives on hold to run against the other side, which is amazing to me. I will never run for office, but I admire those people who do, and people involved in politics. It's much easier for us just to come in here, tell you what to do, and then we go home. That's the easy part is us. You have the hard part. But why are you doing this? It's because you really believe that the other side, if the other side gets elected, it's bad. It's bad for the country. It's bad for the family. It's bad for the future. Right? So that's why you're here to learn and why you are doing all the things that you're doing. So it's easier to do this box first, the negative box. Okay? Now, when we do this in real life, a lot of times people will put issues in here. They're for higher taxes, or they're for more bureaucracy. And that's not going to be, it's too complicated for an average person. It has to be a feeling, an emotion, a reaction. When they see the name Barack Obama, what do you want them to feel? And it should be something negative. It has to be true. I hate doing Bill Clinton boxes because he would just lie. Well, he lies and wins, so we should lie and we'll win. No. I don't particularly like doing Trump boxes either. That gets much more complicated. This is a much easier campaign, so we'll just use this one. So this is the negative box, if you will. Romney on Obama. It's negative. Well, also, you can say distrust five different ways, right? He's a liar. He doesn't tell the truth. He's dishonest. He's less than truthful. So in real life, you would put all of those in here. If you can think of it, you put it in here. You don't sit there with a dictionary looking up new words to put in the box, because average people won't do that. But if the people in the room could think of things, you put them in here. So there'll be 50 things in here. There could be 100 things in here. It'll be a real mess in around 5 minutes. We're going to clean it up. But for right now, that's enough because we have limited time. And you're all geniuses, so you understand what I'm saying. Now we move over to Romney's branding on Romney. So imagine that you're the Mitt Romney campaign team. When voters see the name or hear the name Mitt Romney, what do you want them to think about? What do you want them to feel? Excellent. Sometimes we give away books when people answer the questions well, so you would have gotten a book for saying hope. I don't have any books, but we owe you a book. What else? Remember what Rick said about contrast. Elections are about contrast. So if Obama's a failure, success. Now it has to be true, so you have to think that through. But is Romney a successful person? I think you can make that case. He was governor, he saved the Winter Olympics, he's a successful businessman. So yeah, sure, I think that works. So we'll put success. What else? I would say he's a leader. He's strong. We trust him. And we're just out of room, but again, you get the point. It's positive things, positive feelings that you want voters to think of him. And again, there'll be 50 things in this box. I've done this with campaigns, and this paper tears away and it's got sticky on the back, and we'll put a whole wall will be filled with pages of the positive box, and another wall will be filled with pages of the negative box. Okay, so it takes a while to do this. It's easier to do with a campaign that already happened. But for a campaign that has not yet happened, it can get a little, you know, what do you say? How do you? We'll get there in about 40 minutes. Okay, we're just out of space, out of time. Let's move on. You are now Barack Obama's campaign. Same two questions, very different answers. When the voters see the name Mitt Romney as the Obama campaign, what do you want them to feel or think about him? Just, you can even go generic. What do they always call any conservative? Racist. And here sometimes it's not true, but they do it anyway, so. If it's true, it's better, and that's why conservatives are winning now. They will call you racist, it's not true, and they're losing. So they've overdone it, but that's another lecture, okay? Racist, what else? Silver spoon. I'll just say for the rich, but he was born with a silver spoon in his mouth. For the rich. The fact that he is rich is not as bad as being for the rich, because there are many rich people who get elected because they feel that they're for the people, not for the rich. So it's not just that he is rich, it's that he's for the rich. So that's a good, but it's the silver spoon is the perfect way to do this. What else? Religious fundamentalists, I'll just say extreme. And the reason is you want your message to be as general as possible. So it's not just that he's a religious extremist, but he's extreme on everything. And then religious extremists, you can bring up, or you can bring up he's extreme on other things. So one word is better than two words. And two words is better than four words, okay? The simpler, the better, because you're trying to capture the average person's attention. The average person on a daily basis, particularly with phones, they have appeals to their attention running in the 5 to 10,000 times category daily, where things are trying to pull their attention to those things. And you're one of those on your campaign. So it's difficult to get people interested. So it has to be simple, it has to make sense, it has to be clear. Okay, let's put in some more generic things. How about uncaring? That's always a good one, right? They say that about you, don't they? You don't care about people, right? Unfaithful, sure. But that's part of you can't trust them. Again, we're out of space, but you get the point. Sometimes the negative box is the most fun to do. When I do this in the States, people, they always have a lot to say about why Mitt Romney is terrible. So this box gets very long. Everyone's very enthusiastic about it. Have to calm them down a little. Finally, the positive box on Obama. What would you, if you're the Obama team answering the question, when the voter sees the name Obama, what do you want them to think or to feel? For the people, sure. Again, you can do this somewhat generically with liberals. They're for the people. Diverse. Diversity or just diverse. Stephen, when you do this in the future, make sure she's in the room. Okay. They're going to put trust in here. You can trust them. Now, 4 years before, what was his theme when he first ran? Hope and change, right? After 4 years as president, he couldn't use that again. If you're running as an incumbent, talking about change is very dangerous. Okay? You want stability. It's status quo. You don't want change. So when he was not president, he talked about change. Once he had been president for 4 years, he can't talk about change. And hope, elections are about hope and fear. It's one or the other. Hope is about the future. Fear is more about the past. What's more motivating to voters, hope or fear? Fear is more motivating. I wish it was not like that, but it is. But he ran on hope, and then 4 years later, he had to run on fear. Fear of Mitt Romney. Fear campaigns are very ugly. And you'll see that in the States today. There's no hope with Joe Biden as president. Nobody thinks that that's a hopeful message anymore. So they're just going to scare everyone that if you elect Republicans, the world is going to fall apart. It's going to be fear-mongering, it's going to be ugly, and we'll see if it's successful. I don't think it will be. But it was successful here. They scared people that Mitt Romney was a danger to them. So their theme, I never would have thought of this, but their theme was forward. Do you remember? Obama's re-election was all about moving forward together, and forward is about the future. Okay? So now, in real life, this will be a mess. There'll be 50 things in each box. It's too confusing. You can't use all 50. How many things should you try to reduce this down to? Two? One is great, but it's very hard to do. Two or three? At the most, four. But two or three is best. The fewer, the better. You want to make the choice very clear to the voters. You have their attention for just a few minutes. And your theme is something that you're going to say over and over and over and over again. So you want two or three. So now let's look for what two or three we're going to use. You want the things that are most true and offer the most contrast. As Rick mentioned in his lecture, you want to say things the other side can't say. When I give this lecture and we are talking about people bring their campaign literature to our schools and they ask, is this a good piece of literature? And I've told them just not to bother because it's always terrible. And the reason is if you can take your name or your party's name off of your literature and put your opponent's name on it, and it makes sense, it's not a good piece of literature. Because anyone can say that. Does that make sense? So in Republican primaries, everyone is for low taxes. Everyone is pro-life on abortion. Everyone is pro-gun. There's no difference. So if you just go right to an issue campaign instead of an image campaign, if you start with the issue campaign, there's no contrast with your opponents. You have to go on image. So let's look at the image boxes here. Success versus failure. Look for contrast now. That's pretty good, isn't it? So I'm going to put a star there, success versus failure. Divisive versus leader. Or what's the opposite of divisive? Uniter. So when you do this in real life, usually you don't add things at this point because you have so many things, you don't forget anything. But you could. It's possible. You can add things. You're trying to clean it up, but you might have forgotten something. We're going to add a few things here because we just didn't think of them. We didn't have time to. Uniter versus divider. That's pretty good. Hope versus fear. Maybe. Leader. What's the opposite of a leader? Someone who follows. Or an ideologue. Ideologues don't lead. They follow. Because they're so rigid in their ideology. They're inflexible. What's the opposite of strong? Can we say that Obama is a weak leader? Does that make sense after 4 years? I think so, because there's enough failures to show that. So we can add weak. And you have trust and mistrust. Sometimes this is where we do our polling at this point. We don't do polling to decide what to believe. But you can use polling to decide how do you say it. Okay? We have something in the States called the estate tax. When you die, the government gets a portion of your estate. Is that the same way in Croatia? Does the government get money when someone dies from their estate? No? Well, I'm moving to Croatia.
We don't have it in Poland, so.
You don't have it in Poland either? Well, in the States, when you die, the government gets a portion of your estate. It's another tax. And it goes as high as, it's been as high as 40% of your estate. And now it's lower, but. So we have people who campaign against the estate tax. But you can also call it the death tax, because it's when people die, they get taxed. But it's the same tax, but you just two different ways to say it. It polls 20% different. There will be people who support the estate tax, but they oppose the death tax. It's the same tax, but it's a different name. When you hear an estate, you think of outdoor fountains and gardens and polo ponies and rich people doing stupid things with their money. You might think of Paris Hilton. But when you think of the death tax, well, that's not fair. Someone dies and you tax their. That's how a lot of family farms get broken up, because people, they own the farm, but they're cash poor. But they have to pay 20, 30% to the government. They end up selling the farm so they can afford to pay the taxes. Small businesses, often that happens too. The small business gets sold, the family no longer has a business because the children had to sell it to pay the estate taxes. It's a horrible tax. But when you say death tax, it polls 20% better. So that's an important lesson for language and how you say different things. So I'm just going to pick some. And here's the bottom line. If on election day, when the voters are voting, they see the name Barack Obama and the name Mitt Romney, the first thing they feel, the first thing they think? Romney. He's a strong leader. He's a success. And he'll unite our country. I trust him to unite our country. Obama, he's been a weak failure. He's divisive. I don't trust him anymore. If that's what they're feeling at that point, who will they vote for? Mitt Romney. We haven't even talked about issues, right? But if that's what they're feeling, and it's up to the leadership, it's up to the Romney campaign to pick which of these they're going to do. Sometimes the candidate just says, I'm not going to call my opponent a liar. Well, then use a different word. But I could say, we don't trust him anymore. Okay, I'll do that. You're still talking about the person's honesty. Let's go down here now. For the rich versus for the people. I don't know about in Europe, but in the United States, the left does not talk about helping the poor anymore. Because 30 years ago, people realized, well, helping the poor has turned into helping people who don't deserve it. They're just leeching off of the government. So then it became they were helping the lower middle class. And that didn't work so well. So now it's they're helping the middle class, they're helping all people. That doesn't work too well for them either, but that's how their language has progressed. You notice they're not liberals anymore. They're progressives. Because liberal had a really bad brand to the word. That's why it's not global warming anymore. It's climate change. The left is very, very focused on language. So should you. For the rich, for people. Extreme, what's the opposite of extreme? Mainstream. The left likes that because it rhymes. They like words that rhyme. Mainstream. What's the opposite of forward? Backward, right? We missed that one. So we're going to add it. Backward. And a big one is uncaring. The opposite of uncaring is, very simply, caring. Have you heard the expression, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care? That's important. That's why Mitt Romney never became president, because of that. We'll get to that in about 5 minutes. So if on election day, when the voters see those two names, the first thing they think is Mitt Romney. He's for the rich. He's an extremist. He'll take us backward. And he does not care about people like me. Obama, I don't like everything he's done, but he's still fighting for people like me. He'll continue moving us forward. If that's what they're thinking and feeling, who will they vote for? Obama. It's that simple. Okay? Now, typically, these discussions happen at the top of the party. They're going to come up with the slogan, the messaging, the 2, 3, or 4 themes for that election. And it changes, as it changed for Obama. When Obama first ran for president, hope and change. When he ran for re-election, it was forward and caring. Based on the country changing, the mood of the people changing, his opponent changing. So it's very specific in every campaign, and it will change. Does that make sense? So what do you do if there's multiple candidates or multiple parties? You should do this for your party. When people hear of the Homeland Party, the Homeland Movement, what are the 2 or 3 things you want them to think, want them to feel? It's worth talking about, isn't it? Let's go into some generic differences between the left and the right, and campaigns. This is true almost always. Elections are about the future or the past. They're about change and stability, status quo. Does that make sense? They're also about hope or fear. New versus old. These are just general things that are almost always true. Yes, sir. Yes. Yes. Right. That's correct. Yes. Sure. Yes, they overlap. For example, if they're running on the fear of your getting in, they will talk about stability because that the change that you're offering is destabilizing and would take us backward. So they do overlap. That's a very strong observation. So you got to be careful when you're doing these. But with everything else being equal, people always want to look to the future. They always want what's new. They always want to go in a new direction. Who picked that name? That was a really good one. Somebody, that Margaret Thatcher did. Well, she was smart when it came to politics. New direction, meaning it's forward looking. It's about the future. We want to go in a new direction. Even if you're reinforcing fundamental truths, which we learned in the past. You know, as conservatives in the States, we talk about the Constitution. Well, that's hundreds of years old, but we're not talking about going back to the left will. The left will redefine it. Well, they want to go back to the way things were when there was slavery and when only white men could vote, women couldn't vote. That's what they want to do when they talk about the Constitution. So that's where the battle, you know, that's why you have campaigns. The other side will define it in the worst way possible, and you'll define it in the best way possible. And remember, Ron mentioned this morning, or this afternoon, the most important question in politics is, why? So you want to move us forward in what way? You have to add substance to that. So this is the shorthand, though. But then once you get into it, you have to give the why behind it. Okay? So these are just general things. All things being equal, you want to be the new party of new ideas. Maybe your party is 100 years old rather than two. Republicans and Democrats are 100-year-old parties. But you still have new plans for the future. Okay? So the voters are if the voters are looking at the Harmony movement as fighting for our future, I like that one. Fighting for our future. First of all, they have to put up a fight. If they just want to just status quo everything, then just keep doing what we're doing. I can't believe that people are happy with the way things are going. There'll be some people who are. And you tell them, if you're happy with the way things are going, you should vote for them. You'll get more of the same. If you're happy that our population has gone down 10% in 10 years, fine, vote for them. It'll go down another 10% in 10 years. But I think we need to do things a new way. I think we need to look at new solutions for the future. I just think that the word future is very strong. The word change, since we're trying to change the way we're doing things, is also strong. On school boards in the States, that's become a big issue with the schools. A great slogan is a parent for a change. And that tells them that you're a parent with children in the school system, in the public school system, and no one else on the board is a parent with children in the school system. They're teachers, former teachers, administrators, they're educational experts. There's no parents are on the school board, maybe, in that district. It has to be true. You can't say a parent for a change, and they find out you have no children. Your campaign will crumble if that's what happens. You could say four parents for a change. So it has to be true. It doesn't have to be. I think it should be true. And then hope. The last time we were in Zagreb and we were doing a training, I don't know if anyone here was there, but we talked about the population drain. This happens in the States a lot. There are communities where the left's policies, we talk about how they destroy jobs, right? And we have statistics on the number of jobs and the jobs lost, and it's all very factual, and people fall asleep. I have a job. That doesn't matter to me. So we talk about the left's policies destroy jobs, they destroy companies, they destroy industries. The left would talk about that in a different way. We talk from here. Where do they talk from? They talk from here. We could do that. The left's policies destroy families. They destroy marriages. They destroy families. They destroy communities, not industries. Do you know of people who will never see their children again because they've moved to other countries to find work for a future? They will never see their grandchildren, maybe once a year. That destroys the fabric of our families, of our communities, and our country. The left policies are absolutely destroying the country. At least that's what I understand. They do in Italy. Population of Italy, I think there are more Italian Americans now than there are Italians in Italy. I know there are more Irish Americans than there are in Ireland. How did that happen? Because as Ron mentioned in his slides, look at East and West Germany and North and South Korea. You have abundance, you have affluence, you have success in countries that have embraced free markets and conservative values. I love what the Acton Institute, in every slide that the Acton Institute had, in every sentence, they didn't only talk about free markets. They also talked about values. In every one of them, they did that absolutely on purpose. And they talk about values along with that. In Rick's slides, he talked about values and vision. So let's talk about Mitt Romney again. In the United States, there are basically four major categories of voters for president. And each category represents between 20 and 25% of the voters. It adds up to 87% of all voters. The first category are vision voters. Does the person share my vision of the future? Mitt Romney won vision voters by 8 points. I wish he had won them by more, but he won them by 8 points. Okay, he's off to a good start. So what's your vision for the future? And you probably have a pretty good idea of what the vision for the Harmony Movement is for the future of Croatia, don't you? That's an easy one. Then values. Does a person share my values? Mitt Romney won value voters. I think he won them by 12 points. I wish he had won them by more, but he did win them. Does the person share my values? So you go through what values are we going to focus on in this election. Third category, leadership. When you're voting for the head of the party to lead the country, people want to know about leaders. If you're voting for dog catcher, leadership is not as important. So on the local level, but for mayor, it's important. But maybe on the city council, for the head of the city council, but maybe the lower you go, the less important. But nonetheless, leadership voters. Mitt Romney won leadership voters by 18 points, 18 percentage points. So he won vision, values, and leadership. Why did Mitt Romney not win the election? He won three of the four categories. Because there's that fourth category. Anyone want to guess? I can't hear you.
Emotion.
It is emotion. It's caring. Does the candidate care about people like me? Mitt Romney lost caring voters 81% to 19%. He lost them by more than 60 points. People just didn't like him. That's Donald Trump's problem. Let me rephrase. That's one of Donald Trump's problems, is that there are a lot of people who don't like him. They like his policies, but they don't like him. And I think it cost him the last election. Now, part of his personality is that he's a fighter, so there's an upside to that, but I think the downside is greater. And that's another lecture, so we'll save that. Does the person care about people like me? It is very important that you don't concede caring to the other side if you're a conservative. You should always be talking about that. Now, that's their two boxes down here, caring versus uncaring. We don't want to talk about that. Well, if you're losing it by 60 points, you need to talk about it. So don't be afraid to talk about it. You care about the future of Croatia as much as the other side does. Never give up on that. Always talk about it. And it's easy if you're talking about the grandparents who will never see their grandchildren because your policies chased away the children. There have to be thousands of examples of that. If you're losing population by 10%, there are examples of that everywhere. So this is how all these lectures connect. Tell that story. That's Ron's lecture on storytelling. Tell that story. You have the vision. Families that stay together. That's the vision. The value are family values. Now you're talking about the future. And now you're talking about the policies. So now we have, say, three themes in each of these, right? Now we're going to talk about issues. We mentioned we want to keep the number of themes as small as possible. No more than four. Three or two is better, one's best. It's rare. How many issues could you talk about in the campaign? Over the course of your campaign, how many issues could you talk about? A million. A million. I don't know what country Russia is going to invade tomorrow. It's a whole new set of issues, right? I can't predict the future. There are thousands of issues you could talk about, right? So which issues do you pick? Now, you can't always pick the issue that's on the front page. The press knows this, by the way. The press is liberal. They put the issue on the front page they want you to talk about. When they stick a microphone in your face, they're asking you a question they want to ask you on the issue that favors the left. That's what's going on. So you just have to be prepared for that, and you need to get back on your issue. Which issue should you talk about? This is not just an exercise. The issue that puts you in your two boxes. Those are the issues you want to talk about. So if you're saying Obama is a failure as president, you got to think of some examples. It's one thing to say it to the voters, but they'll say, prove it to me. Oh, he's been a failure. That sounds terrible. Remind me, what's he failed on? Well, he failed on the slowest economic recovery since the Great Depression. The highest unemployment, over 8% unemployment for the most months since the Great Depression. A record number of Americans are on food stamps. The left thinks that's a success, by the way. But we would argue that's a failure. What happened in Benghazi? That's a failure. There was an IRS scandal. That's a failure. Obamacare. You can keep your doctor. That was a lie and a failure. The rollout of Obamacare was a disaster. But you just start listing all the examples. You should have 10 examples of each one of these things. Mitt Romney is a success. We already talked about that. He saved the Olympics. He's a successful businessman. He was governor of a state with a majority, supermajority of Democrats in the state legislature, and yet he worked with them. If you're talking about any of those issues, you're winning because you're in your box talking about the successes of Romney and the failures of Obama. Does that make sense? So that's very important. But if you don't do this first, every day you wake up, what should we talk about today? I don't know. Let's talk about double parking. Let's talk about speed limits. Let's talk about, you can talk about anything. And your campaign is disorganized, unorganized, unfocused, and to an average voter, very confusing. Because it's too much. They don't know, what are you trying to tell us? By the way, this is why lawyers make such good candidates. Lawyers make great candidates because the campaign is a trial. A lawyer says, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, that's the voters in a campaign. That's the jury, right? I will prove beyond a reasonable doubt that the defendant is either guilty or not guilty. I notice you didn't say innocent. You must be a lawyer, because we all know he did it. That's why we're here. But you just can't prove it. So lawyers won't say my client is innocent, because the jury's saying he's not innocent. He did it. We just, you know, can we prove it or not? It's just a little joke. And then over the course of the trial, both lawyers, what do they use to make their point? To prove or disprove, what are they using? Arguments based on evidence. Your evidence are the issues. Your evidence that voters should think of the election like this are the issues that you talk about. The other side wants to talk about the issues that bring you down here. So that's the battle in a campaign. That's what they're doing to you. If you didn't know it, now you do. So now there's two parts to issues. There's two parts to issues. The most important part of issues is which issue do you choose to talk about? That is the most important thing. If you're talking about your issue, you're winning. The second part of an issue is how you talk about it. But the most important part is, are you picking the right issue? So, for example, if you support what's going on in Ukraine, if you support arming the Ukrainians, if you're talking about the war in Ukraine, you're winning. Because that's the policy now that's... Now, it's better to talk about it in a good way, but if you're just talking about it, you're probably winning the argument. Because it forces the other side to say, well, we shouldn't be doing this. We should side with Putin. That's a tough position to be in, I think. But whatever the themes are, so you figure out your themes. If your themes are fighting for the future, you should have an agenda of issues that focus on the future. If your theme is let's keep families and communities together, then you should have an issue agenda that will do that. We want to reform the judicial system. We want to reform the administrative state. We want to change the rules, regulations, and laws so people have hope for the future. That's our agenda. Well, then it makes sense to people that you are fighting for the future. So the issues that you choose, and you can make up issues by writing legislation to do something focused on your themes, or let the other side set the agenda, which you don't want. Let's talk very quickly about multi-candidate, multi-party systems. By the way, every issue could have four boxes, how you talk about it, which we won't get into, but every issue can. On the estate tax, first, we want to call it the death tax. We want to focus on family farms and small businesses that have to close because of the death tax. And we're going to tell those stories. We're going to find people whose businesses, third, fourth generation businesses that had to shut. Family farms. In the States, they used to have, the left was very worried about family farms. Willie Nelson did concerts to raise money to help save the family farm. Do you think that the family farm has been saved and that's why they don't do it anymore? No, they don't do it anymore because it was pointing out the reason why they have to close is because of the estate tax that you guys support. So they stopped doing the concerts and that's not a thing on the left anymore. If you have a multi-candidate, multi-party situation, who is the main opponent that you have? Which political party is it important for them not to get over a certain percent? Can you group the parties together? We're the only ones that are fighting for the future. We're the only ones with a future focus. That's what Trump did in his primary. He had 15 other politicians and he put them all in the same box. Do you think the country is headed in the right direction? No? Let's say it's yes. If you think the country is headed in the right direction, vote for one of these other guys. Doesn't matter which one. Split the vote. Vote for one of them. You'll get more of the same. I think as the new party with a new direction, with a fighting for the future, you can say that. If you think that Croatia is headed in the right direction, you're satisfied with the way things are going, you're satisfied with the destruction of families and communities, losing 10% of our population, if you're okay with that, you should vote for these other guys. But if you're not, you should vote for us. So group them together. And there's three ways to group to do your targeting, and I'll finish with this. There's geographic targeting, there's demographic targeting, and there's issues targeting. And those three are distinct, so I want to mention them. Geographically, is your party particularly strong in one part of the country for some reason? And maybe that's a big advantage. Two, demographics. Maybe it's strong amongst men or women or a certain religion, or a certain occupation, maybe with veterans. So that's an advantage you have. And the third and final is issues targeting. We usually start at issues targeting because we're all into issues and we forget sometimes the others. Okay? So that is 6 hours of lecture in 1 hour. I think you guys get this much quicker than most audiences that we teach this to. So I want to appreciate your time. Are there any questions real quickly? Seeing none, thank you for your time. Thank you for your attention.